Hello, my name is Patrick Whitehead. I'm Associate Professor of Psychology at Albany State University, and in the short video, I'm going to explain how and why I internationalized my human growth and development curriculum. Here's a short outline, and for the sake of time, I'm just going to leave it here for a second so you can review what it is I'll be covering. The first topic is, why bother internationalizing a human growth and development class? Well, it's important to recognize that countries around the world are becoming more and more diverse, and the United States certainly is no exception. Native Americans have been the minority for centuries, and then what we think of as the early settlers in the United States from England, representing the United Kingdom, and other European countries, are also no longer the majority. We're seeing rapid diversity occurring. And so there are few first cultures as majorities anymore. So first cultures are ones that are seen as people of that country. And so for us, Native Americans haven't been the majority in a good while. Second culture people are ones that are born in one culture and move or migrate or emigrate to another. And so they now live in a culture that they weren't born into. And then finally, third culture is relatively new, but it's becoming increasingly common where people are born into a culture and have parents representing more than one culture. And sometimes they can even move then to another. And so there can be as many as four different cultures into which someone has been born or are now living. So to which culture do they belong? And which one do they learn about? Which one do they practice? Human development isn't fixed. We might think that once you get it, it's good. We understand what childhood is, what late childhood is. But even if we look at adolescence, which we all recognize or often recognize as a stage of development, that's relatively new. It's about 100 years old. So the proposal for adolescence as a stage of development is new. And there's a newer one yet. And this has been proposed in the last 20 years or so called emerging adulthood. It used to be that after high school, into someone's late teens, they enter the labor force. Well, those sorts of jobs aren't as popular anymore, aren't as available anymore. And so people have to go to school, and the period at which young adults are becoming young adults is getting later and later. So there's this almost decade-long span called emerging adulthood, which Jeff Arnett has argued and described in a number of publications. And so there are a couple of points as to why emerging adulthood has occurred. And again, for the sake of time, I'm going to skip over them. I just want to demonstrate that human development is in flux. It isn't fixed. It will continue to change as we pass through periods of historical change. All right, in the past, I've tried to introduce a lot of different cross-cultural concepts in human development, but I've decided this semester to pick only one and then practice it in a number of generalizable ways so that students can become comfortable with that practice. And so the concept I've chosen is the difference between individualism and collectivism, which briefly can be defined as follows. Individualistic cultures emphasize the achievements of the individual, so its success is determined by what the person has done, the individual person has done. In a collectivistic culture, it's about the achievements of a community. It's less important to look at individual achievements. Any individual achievement is seen as an achievement of the group. And so it seems like a subtle difference, but it has profound consequences when you look at human development. So in the West, in the United States and continental Europe, developmental psychology emphasizes the ego. So it's the development of the ego. It's becoming autonomous as an individual. It's becoming individuated. It's becoming independent. It's becoming self, or being able to take care of yourself. It's all about the person. Now, how might that look in a collectivistic culture? Well, it's not something we have practice in unless we come from a collectivistic culture. And so that's what the goal is of this internationalization. So I've split this into five different modules, an introductory module, an introduction to the concept I want them to practice, and then three different applications. And so if you look at the entire curriculum, it's about 50% of the main developmental transitions receive this internationalization component. So they are maternal care, coming of age, and old age after the concepts themselves are introduced. And each module here is divided into three main components. The first is a brainstorm component where students reflect on what counts as maternal care and developmental psychology, what's important, who defines what's important. And then they're exposed to a collectivistic approach to the same topic, maternal care, coming of age, old age. And then they do a Venn diagram comparing and contrasting individualism and collectivism, recognizing that there's more than one thing that counts as important with each of these transitions. All right, so let's see what that looks like in an example here. So with maternal care and prenatal care, I have students watch a video on indigenous child care practices or childbirth and care practices in British Columbia. So these are indigenous people up above Washington State. So they've been doing this practice for many centuries, going back many centuries. But before they look at that, they reflect on what do we know about maternal care in medical practice. Well, it's all about the health, the cardiovascular, the development, the physiological, developmental, neurological, developmental health of the mother and then the unborn child. And then after the child is delivered, it's testing vital signs, it's comparing normal developmental processes with everyone else, or the child's development with what's considered normal. And so the medical expert is the one to whom everyone looks to for guidance and counsel. And if you look to a different source of expertise, like you use a doula, for example, you have to like sign a waiver saying like I'm going against medical recommendations or medical advice. And so it's highly medicalized. But in a collectivistic community, we see the spiritual practitioners being there. There's body massage, there's nutrition, obviously. Well, that's a part of an individualistic approach as well. But the community pools its resources to help the pregnant mother. And then after the child is delivered, it's not just about the child or the mother. It's also about the earth. It's about the ecosystem. And so oftentimes they take the placenta, they don't just discard it. They bury it next to a tree or maybe plant a tree with it so that the placenta can nourish nature and then nature can nourish the infant. And so it's very it's taking a step back and looking at it in context and appreciating the circle of life. In coming of age, we think of becoming an adult as an achievement. You graduate from high school, you get married, you move out, you take care of yourself. It's all about, I did it, I did it, I did it. But in a collectivistic community or collectivistic culture, it's an achievement of the community. The family has succeeded. And in many cases, the goal isn't moving out. The goal is being able to look after your elders. And that's considered a great honor. It's not a burden. It's not something that one must do if one is so unfortunate as to have to take care of his or her elders. It's considered the sign of ability or great wealth if you can take care of people in your family. I have students watch a video on a quinceañera celebration in Mexico. And here we see the girl who's celebrating her 15th anniversary or her 15th birthday. She's happy, but her parents are who the party is about. And so the parents, the pastor, the church congregation, the family, they're all there to celebrate the family's success. And so it's very clear, even from the daughter's perspective, that this party is about my parents. They're the ones that take such pride in what's happened. And finally, we look at old age. In the US and continental Europe, old age is not something we look forward to. In fact, if you look at all the lotions and surgical procedures, it's all about staying as young for as long as possible. People who are old are a burden to others, so they try to delay that as long as possible. But in a collectivistic community, of course, elders are held in high esteem. It's something that they do look forward to. It exhibits strength, not weakness. And it shows strong family lines, genetic lines. And it's also an opportunity to express true wealth. Wealth isn't about being able to buy stuff or have power. It's about being able to give when nothing is necessary to give. You're no longer taking care of kids. You're no longer paying your bills. You're able to give out of the wealth of what you are and who you are. So being able to give of your time, also having the time to spend doing things that you really enjoy. These are things that you can look forward to in old age that you don't have the advantage of doing as an adult. And so that comes from a chapter written by a physician by the name of Drew Leader, who's done a lot of philosophy of medicine, but he's focusing now on old age. And so that's not a video, it's a chapter that they read. So with all of those, the students are guided through this practice of comparing and contrasting individualism and collectivism in the context of human development. And by doing it over and over again, my hope is that they can look at any phase of human development and say, you know what, the way that it's practiced in the West isn't the only way that this is done. In fact, there may be others that would reject medical advice because it's not all about the medical expert, for example, or what it means to grow up isn't all about what I can do for myself. It's about a deeper recognition of my involvement in the community. And so there are a lot of different ways to apply this. Since I'm giving this talk via video, I can't respond to questions now, but please feel free to shoot me an email if you have any follow-up questions. Thank you.